Good morning, and a very warm welcome to each of you on this beautiful Lord's Day. As always, it is such a joy and such a privilege to join together this morning and to come before the Lord and His Word in an act of worship. And this morning, as we come before the Lord in worship, I want to read as a call to worship from Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and from verse 9 through to verse 14. It says, "Not only was the teacher wise, but also he imparted knowledge to the people. He pondered and searched out and set in order many proverbs. The teacher searched to find just the right words, and what he wrote was upright and true. The words of the wise are like goads, their collected sayings like firmly embedded nails given by one shepherd. Be warned, my son, of anything in addition to them. Of making many books there is no end, and much study wearies the body. Now all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of this matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or evil." Let us open with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, this morning we come before You as Your sons and Your daughters to worship You, to praise Your mighty name. As we come before Your word this morning, Father, we thank You that we have this joyous opportunity. Once again, we have this privilege to come before Your word, to delve deeper into Your word, and to have You open our eyes and our hearts to the word that You have for us this morning. Father, we pray for guidance. We pray that You would now still our hearts, that You would remove the stumbling blocks that lay before us, that we would be attentive to the moving of Your Spirit, and that what we hear this morning from You, what Your word teaches us, we pray that it would not fall upon deaf ears, but that we would take it to heart, and that we would be encouraged to apply that to our lives, that we would seek You in all things, and that we would glorify You. We ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning, we are going to be looking at two passages. 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1 to verse 5, and then Mark chapter 6, verse 1 to verse 6. And when we look at these passages, what I want to highlight this morning comes basically in three parts. It is three aspects that we see in these passages. The first one is an understanding of two kings some 1,000 years apart. The second is the understanding of two very different welcomes that each of these kings received. And then finally, it is an understanding on the outcomes of their different kingships. And to that end, let's have a look at our readings this morning. Firstly, from 2 Samuel chapter 5. It says, "All the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, 'We are your own flesh and blood. In the past, while Saul was king over us, You were the one who led Israel on their military campaigns. And the Lord said to you, you will shepherd my people Israel, and you will become their ruler. When all the elders of Israel had come to King David at Hebron, the king made a compact with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned 40 years. In Hebron, he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem, he reigned over all Israel and Judah 33 years. And then from Mark chapter 6, verses 1 to verse 6. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. Where did this man get these things? They asked. What's this wisdom that has been given him, that he even does miracles? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without honor. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith. Now, firstly, let's take a look at this understanding of these two kings. See, on the one hand, we see in 2 Samuel chapter 5, the introduction to David as the king of Israel. We remember that David was first introduced to us as a simple shepherd boy. And David kind of rose to fame, as it were, initially for his musical talents, and later on for his heroic defeat of the giant Goliath. And of course, David became a favorite to King Saul. However, Saul grew more and more untrusting of David for fear that David would be after his throne. And so Saul turns on David. Yet ultimately, when Saul, as well as his son Jonathan, who would have succeeded Saul should Saul die, which in fact is exactly what happened, except for the fact that both Saul and Jonathan died, David is anointed as king over Israel at the age of only 30. And I suspect his primary objective as king was to unite all the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, when we look at David, we understand the fact that David is a great king. But he was not without flaws. Everything from murder to adultery to the constant threat of war as he tries to increase Israel's territory and as he tries to unify the tribes. David is still viewed as a man after God's own heart. But ultimately, when we look at David as a king, what we see is a brilliant tactician. He is a almost conquering hero to the people. He is, in fact, a military king. That is how David is seen. And yet, on the other hand, when we look at Mark chapter 6, we see Jesus entering his hometown. And we are first introduced to this concept of Jesus as being king at his birth. See, Jesus is born of the Virgin Mary and of Joseph. Joseph, his father, who was a lowly carpenter. And we are told in the Gospel of Matthew that at the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem, they are visited by the Magi. We also have come to know them from a very young age as the wise men. And it is at this point that the Magi first use this term. And that comes out when they are speaking to King Herod. And they use this term, King of the Jews, to refer to Jesus. And this, in essence, solidifies the understanding that Jesus truly is king. We, of course, remember the circumstances around his birth. The fact that from birth there was a price on his head. That his birth was not glamorous as one would expect from a king, but instead was born in a humble stable surrounded by the animals. Yet there is not much recorded about Jesus's childhood. Basically, anything up until the age of 30, when Jesus begins his public ministry. But what we see from the beginning of this public ministry is the opposite of what the Jews expected. And of course, it is the opposite of what David sets out to do. You see, Jesus was not this conquering military type king. He was, in fact, a humble servant to the people of God. He was a teacher. He was a preacher. He was a miracle worker. And of course, remembering that he is fully God and he is fully human. He is, in fact, the perfect king. He is holy, he is righteous, and he is without sin or blemish. And of course, what the Jews were expecting was not this lowly carpenter king. They wanted a military hero to ride in, something like that David figure. Someone who would save them from the oppressive rule of the Romans. They wanted someone who would liberate them from this sense of bondage and to restore Israel to some sense of its former glory. And I suspect that they were anticipating that this would only be able to come by way of the sword. And of course, this was not the intention of God. It was not by the sword that salvation would come. But as Jesus taught, salvation would come through him. Salvation would come through faith in him. And this now leads us on to our second point this morning. And that is the understanding of two very different welcomes. Again, we look first at 2 Samuel chapter 5. With the death of both Saul and Jonathan, we see the leaders of the tribes of Israel recount David's call from the Lord, which actually happened many years before this moment. It was during David's youth that the Lord had rejected Saul as the king, and then had Samuel, the prophet Samuel, anoint David as the new king. And this is what I believe the people held on to when looking at David. This was now reflected in the way in which the people accepted David as their rightful king. It was not simply an acknowledgement of his authority as king, but instead David makes this covenant with the people of God. And it is a covenant that is made before the Lord. And they then anoint David as king for a second time. This we see as a very welcoming moment in David's life. A complete accepting of his authority and his rule over the people as their ordained, consecrated, and anointed king. And again, we see the complete opposite happening in Mark chapter 6. Jesus, in his own town, begins to teach in the synagogue on the Sabbath. And we are told that there were many who heard the teachings and were amazed at this. That is what Mark tells us. There were many who heard him and were amazed. Now, we can obviously speculate at what that term amazed actually is referring to here, but I suggest that this is not a sincere sense of amazement. This is not a joyous amazement, because they begin to ask questions. Who is this? Isn't he a carpenter? Isn't he this or that or the next thing? And then, most astonishingly, they actually take offense with Jesus. And once again, I must highlight the fact that Jesus was not the king that they expected, nor was he the king that they wanted. In essence, their offense relates more to the fact that they felt that there was no reason for them to almost believe in the words that Jesus taught, because in their eyes they saw him as simply a carpenter, as a commoner, as someone who was exactly the same as them. And if there is this belief that he is no different to them, then their view of him as a king, never mind a prophet, but as a king, would ultimately be non-existent. And of course, we can take that one step further. If their view of him was non-existent then as a king, surely their view of him as the anointed one from God would be the last thing on their minds. And so Jesus acknowledges, and he himself is amazed at their lack of faith. And this then brings us to our final point, and that is the understanding of very different outcomes to these two kingships. See, when we look at David's kingship, that is, when we look at David's rule as king, 2 Samuel chapter 5 tells us that David ruled over Judah for 7.5 years, and then he ruled over all of Israel for a further 33 years, that is 40 years in total. And he is renowned, I believe, for uniting all the tribes of Israel, for his many wars and victories in leading the people. That is something that they remember before anointing him as their king, because he was the one who carried them through their military conquests, as it were. He is renowned for his faithfulness as a man after God's own heart. But even in his success as a king, as a military ruler, as a great tactician, even with the number of successful conquests that he had, we cannot overlook the fact that David is still just a man. As I've mentioned before, there was this constant threat of war in the unifying of the tribes of Israel. There, of course, is the scandal of adultery and, of course, of murder. And ultimately, the destruction and the breaking up of what David had sought out to do, although that comes much later in the history of Israel. But his kingdom would be rocked to its absolute core with the multiple exilic periods, where foreign nations came in and conquered Israel and then took her people for themselves, removed them from their own homelands, and then planted them in foreign lands. But at the same time, even with the multiple facets of David as a person, and the multiple facets of David as a ruler, as the king of Israel, he was viewed ultimately as a successful king. But when we look at Jesus, though, he taught thousands within the synagogues. He taught upon the shores, on the mountaintops, in the villages, and wherever he felt the need to do so, even on the steps of the temple. He performed many miracles, ranging from the casting out of demons to the physical healing of the sick, from the raising of the dead to the feeding of the 4,000 and the 5,000 with a few fish and a few pieces of bread, from the concise and revelatory way in which he taught the word of God, to the calming of nature itself. Jesus clearly had ultimate authority as king, but more importantly, as God himself, remembering always that Jesus is one third of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And yet many people were still unwilling to follow him, which ultimately leads to his crucifixion, his death, but also his glorious resurrection. David brings in a completely new idea of kingdom in some ways, a unified force under the authority of one single man, as opposed to the conventional idea of the 12 tribes. But this is still completely and utterly a human rule under the grace of God. What David offers is a kingdom protected largely by numbers, but will ultimately come to an end as the people return to their wicked ways of idolatry and their rejection of God. What Jesus brings is not a human-based kingdom. It is much more profound than that. This is the very kingdom of God ushered in through the coming of Christ Jesus himself. And this kingdom will not pass away through the generations like so many kingdoms that had come before. This is not a kingdom that is at war with itself, as we have seen with so many kingdoms before it, where there is this constant jostling for position and power. This kingdom is God's kingdom, and it will last for all eternity. Jesus is the one true king over all things, whether it is things in heaven or things on earth. And this is the kingdom that you and I belong to. One that will not fail, one that will not crumble, one that will not be overthrown by any power. It is one that will last for all eternity. And in these times, I plead and I pray that we would choose this kingdom, that we would not reject the Lord as so many people have done in the past, that we would not run after earthly kingdoms or earthly powers as the ultimate authority in our lives, but that we would trust in God, that we would trust in Jesus, that we would trust in the Holy Spirit, and that we would hold on to the assurance that through Jesus Christ, God has called us into this kingdom, that we are co-heirs with Christ, that we are dearly loved and cherished by him. And for this, we thank you, Lord, for the gift of your grace, for the gift of countless blessings and countless mercies in our lives, but also for the gift of salvation received through the one true King. And his name is Jesus. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we come before you, Lord, humbled and ever so grateful that you have given to us the opportunities and the assurance of your heavenly kingdom here on earth. And though this kingdom has not been fully realized to us, though we cannot see your kingdom in all its glory and all its majesty, you have promised to us that when Christ returns on that day, when we are united with him in his glory, we will see more clearly than ever before. That we will spend an eternity in your kingdom. A kingdom unlike anything we have seen before. A kingdom that is at peace. A kingdom where there is no hurt, there is no pain, there is no suffering. A kingdom ruled by a just King, by the one true King. We thank you, Lord, that we are co-heirs with Christ in that kingdom. And that by your grace and your love and your mercy, we have received salvation, the key that gains us access to this kingdom. We pray, Lord, for a renewing of faith, that we would never turn away from you, that we would never reject you, but that we would stand firm in the truth that you have given to us through your word and by the moving of the Holy Spirit within us as he reveals that word to us. We praise you, Lord, on this day and forever more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Reverend Maniraj Sukdaven will now share with us in Holy Communion.
Let us stand on the promises of God's word that says, if we have asked God for forgiveness, he will forgive us. And as forgiven people, therefore, I invite you to the table of the Lord to enjoy that which is laid here before us. And let us therefore do that this morning, as we would once again go back to what Paul says in his word and listen as we partake of exactly how he asks us to partake. He says, for I received from the Lord, which I also handed down to you, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread. He gave thanks and he broke it and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. And then he said, eat, and as often as you do so in memory of me. Let us therefore eat as we do so in memory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In like manner, Paul says, and he repeats what Jesus said in the book of Mark. He took the cup, and Paul says, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this is my body, this is my blood, which is poured for you. And he says, drink. And as often as you do so in memory of me. Let us drink together. Jesus also said further, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood." It's a new covenant. Therefore, remember, the Old Testament was a covenant of promise. The New Testament is a covenant of fulfillment, sealed by what we have participated in this morning. May God's grace be with you and abide with you. Shall we pray together? Heavenly Father, we thank you that as we celebrate this weekend, as we also remember what we are celebrating, and as we also partake of what we are celebrating, that Lord, we will treasure these moments, we will treasure these memories, and we will live the life that you have called upon every one of us to live, that know you, that every day of our lives may be a day of sacrifice, as you sacrifice for us. Let us also sacrifice for you. Let us take up that cross and follow you. May the grace of God, therefore, rest and abide with you. Amen. Thank you very much, and may you have a blessed day further. Worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether.